In this video, we'll learn discourse network analysis. It is a network approach to analyze qualitative data. Discourse network analysis is built on network analysis. It is used to analyze qualitative content. It is particularly helpful as you analyze discourse that is related to policy. In the domain of policy analysis, it is a quite new method. The history of discourse network analysis is about 10 years old. Despite a short history, the foundation of the discourse analysis is well established in network analysis. A discourse network, in essence, is a two-mode network. Let's refresh our memory. What's a two-mode network? The network has two types of nodes. In a discourse network, one type of nodes is actors, and another type of nodes is claims. If an actor made a claim, you use a tie to connect the two nodes. You can use many network analysis software to conduct a discourse network analysis, such as R and Discourse Network Analyzer. Here, I provide an example of how to manage the discourse data in UCINet. I created a node list in UCINet. The first column represents the nodes. In policy discourse, they are policy actors who made claims or statements of policy. They could be legislators, interest groups, government agencies, businesses, academics, and community groups. The rest of the columns represent the claims. A claim is a verbal or written expression that is in favor of or against a policy. For example, I read the policy discourse and coded that school district superintendents, teachers, and education researchers expressed that it is misleading to have a summative score of school performance in the state accountability system. The actors are school district superintendents, teachers, and education researchers. Their claim is that it is misleading to have a summative score of school performance in the state accountability system. To connect the policy actors and their claims, I put them in the same row. If you visualize the node list on the left, you get a network on the right. Actor 1 made claim 1 and 2, so I use a tie to connect actor 1 to claim 1 and 2, respectively. Actor 2 made claim 2, 3, and 4, then I use a tie to connect actor 2 to claim 2, 3, and 4, respectively. With this two-mode network, you can use all the network analytical techniques we've learned over the past few weeks to conduct network analysis. Here is an example of how I built a two-mode network of the 2020 Democratic presidential candidates' education policy proposals. There were 29 Democratic candidates who announced their 2020 presidential campaigns. The candidates are on the left of the two-mode network. Their policy proposals are on the right. The ties represent who proposed what education policies. To conduct a discourse network analysis, you can convert the two-mode network to a one-mode network by actors. How to interpret the ties in the newly converted one-mode network? We've already learned in the two-mode network analysis that you always go back to the original two-mode network. In the two-mode network on the left, the ties represent which actors made what claims. So in the one-mode network by actors on the right, a tie connects a pair of actors if they made the same claim. The clusters in this one-mode network are sometimes called actor coalitions. The interpretation is based on the assumption that the actors shared the same belief of a policy. Therefore, they have the potential of becoming allies if they haven't built the coalition together. For example, this is the one-mode network of the 2020 Democratic presidential candidates' education policy Similarity Network. The network was converted from the two-mode network that includes the candidates and their education policy proposals. After the network conversion, the one-mode network has only candidates. The ties connect a pair of candidates who made the same policy proposals. The thicker the ties, the stronger the ties. It means a pair of candidates' education policy proposals were more similar than others. With this network, you can calculate node centrality. High centrality nodes tend to be the influential nodes based on the similarity of their claims. Who has the highest degree centrality in this network, and who has the highest betweenness centrality in this network? Joe Biden had the highest degree centrality. What does degree centrality mean? It means the number and the weight of the direct ties a node has. In this network, Joe Biden's proposed education policies were similar to many other candidates' policy proposals. I conducted this analysis in April 2020, 4 months before the Democratic convention was held in August 2020. Harris had the highest betweenness centrality in this network. What does betweenness centrality mean? It means a node functions as a bridge between clusters and subgroups in the networks. In this case, Harris' proposed education policies had some similarity to the cluster colored in pink color. Her policy also had some similarities to the cluster colored in green color. So she functioned as a bridge between the two clusters based on the policy similarity. With these results, 4 months before the Democratic convention, you identified the two most influential education policy actors among the 29 candidates. Biden and Harris were influential policy actors in this network, as indicated by different centrality measures. There were many reasons that Harris was picked by Biden as his running mate. Education was not the most important issue among Democrats. Healthcare was the most important issue, followed by gun policy, climate change, and education. Even though education was not the most important issue, at least on the issue of education, Harris, as a running mate, could potentially bring in the policy coalition in green color in the network, promoting a unified education policy platform. To conduct a discourse network analysis, you can also track the networks over time and see how the network density and clustering coefficient have changed over time. What you see on the screen is the monthly change of the networks as the candidates dropped out of the presidential campaign. By the end of April 2020, all candidates on the periphery of the network had ended their campaigns. Biden and Sanders were the only two candidates who were still in the campaign. If you run for the president, you'd better occupy a central position in the policy similarity network. After you convert the two-mode network by actors, you can also convert the two-mode network to a one-mode network by claims. In the network on your right, if a pair of claims are expressed by the same actor, you use a tie to connect the nodes. For example, there is a tie between claim 5 and 6. It means both claims are expressed by policy actor 4. You can consider the new network as the policy co-occurrence network. If a claim has a high degree centrality, what does it mean? It means that the claim has a high frequency of co-occurring with other policy claims. For example, claim 3 has the highest degree centrality in the network. It means claim 3 has the highest frequency of co-occurring with other claims. It co-occurred with claim 1, 2, 4, 5, and 6. When a policy actor made other claims, the policy actors always brought up claim 3. Actor 3 made claim 3 and 1. Actor 2 made claim 3 and 2. Actor 2 also made claim 3 and 4. And then actor 4 made claim 3 and 5. Actor 4 also made claim 3 and 6. Obviously, claim 3 is an important issue. In this network of the 2020 Democratic Presidential Candidates Education Co-occurrence Network, the policy proposals that had high centrality degree include Policy 36, Increased School Safety, Policy 8, Universal Pre-Kindergarten Programs, Policy 43, Increased Investment in School Infrastructure, Policy 45, Increased Title I Funding, Policy 19, Free Tuition and Fees at 2- and 4-year Public Colleges, and Policy 1, Teacher Pay Raise. Here is another example of discourse network analysis. To study the discourse related to the Every Student Succeeds Act that was passed in 2015, I used the congressional hearing data to code which policy actors made what claims, and then analyze the policy actor coalitions based on their policy claims. Discourse network analysis has been used to study the European discourse on software patents. Researchers analyzed how an anti-software patent coalition gained control over important political claims, while the pro-software patent discourse coalition was not able to gain influence. Discourse network analysis was also used to study policy change, such as pension policies in Germany. In this video, we learned discourse network analysis. It is a network approach to analyze qualitative data. Discourse network analysis is built on network analysis, and it is used to analyze qualitative content. To conduct a discourse network analysis, the technical side is relatively easy. The important part is to have a good understanding of the theoretical foundations of networks. Otherwise, you won't be able to understand why you click some buttons in the network analysis software but not others. In this case, without an understanding of two-mode networks, you won't be able to interpret your analytical results. And this is similar to all research methods.